Musik von euren Lieblingsstars. Set.
And the Yunge Eylands forecast through to midnight tonight.
Britain, southerly, 5, occasionally slowly at a time. Rain or showers, occasionally becoming poor. New Britain, north by west, 2, rising more slowly later, 4, showers, rain. Moderate, then becoming poor later. Zealand, west 4 or 3, backing 5 or 6 later. Fine, occasional showers, moderate, good,
losing its identity.
New Zealand, northeast 8 or 9, west backing southwest, good,
for a time,
occasionally very high,
good.
Iceland, variable 3 or 5, becoming south 5 or 6,
very violent showers, then showers,
occasionally more good at first. New Iceland,
far away by 7, 3 or 4,
however, misty but
becoming
dull,
pleasant,
clear enough,
moderate.
Hebrides,
westwesterly becoming southerly, becoming roughly westerly later, less,
cloudy,
close,
damp,
finally
brief,
melting,
heavy,
bloom,
now falling,
hovering,
rising more slowly.
New Hebrides,
north,
2, 7,
developing,
becoming,
enveloping,
showers,
swells,
spells,
good,
yes, good.
Good.
Instructions on how to make a wireless set. Let's go back, first of all, to the very beginning and your first interest in wireless, is it? Or
Yeah, exactly. I like to think of the waves that invisibly are sort of dancing in the air and sort of catching these waves into the machine and making the machine sound. So it's a sort of...
Yeah, it's a sort of...
Yeah, it's really like you're catching.
Catching something.
Yeah, and then listening to the distance. It's also like that. It's
you catch something?
It's you catch the
and
wave.
You listen to something that's happening very far away.
Yeah, it's a little bit like a spy.
Spying, if you will. But
not in a bad way.
Just like...
Learning?
Learning.
Could you describe this piece of equipment here on the table? Could you describe the shape of it?
So there's a recording that has been done before, and it gets put into the device, and there is like magnetic bands that turn, and they turn, and basically the voice,
so the sound gets turned into,
gets put onto those magnetic bands,
and then they turn,
and that changes them into waves, into like.
Into wavelengths, and then these wavelengths get broadcasted out of the device
through electricity.
Now, tell me just a little bit more about the transmitter, would it please, Mr. Simpson?
How a radio works.
So a radio works.
So are we talking technical terms here, or
the transmitter was made up of bits and pieces that were obtained, and.
I would, yes.
So, how a radio works?
So radio works.
A radio works like that, that it...
As a sender?
Should I say that? A sender?
That it receives the radio waves from a center somewhere in the country. And then...
That brings you...
Basically...
entertainment?
After that signal receives the radio, you hear the sounds from the radio,
interview or music,
or something like that.
And when did you hear first voice or music from the air?
Well, if I'm talking about specific memories of the radio, I remembered specifically being like glued to the radio when I was listening to some handball. Icelandic handball, you know, competing against the Russians or something. This was always a big thing, and because we could actually achieve something in handball, we were quite okay. But otherwise, the radio is just like constantly on at my home. It was just like always on.
I love the radio. I listen to the radio every day.
That's sort of what they did.
Like every day.
You just wake up and you turn on the radio.
The radio number one in Iceland, that's what I listen to every day.
It's just always there. It's like a furniture.
It's a big part of my life.
But then, of course, there were also... Like I say, sometimes you were really glued to the radio. Like in the 30s sort of experience. It's like really listening.
And then there is this other channel that is music from the 80s. I love it.
And also sometimes I remembered I listened to some concerts actually in the old days. Also as a child, I would listen to live concerts of something. Symphonic stuff.
That's where you sing and dance to, you know.
Yeah. Then I would be like really give my time to really listen to the radio. So
it's unbelievable.
Yeah.
If you, after a hard day or you feeling down or something, just turn on the radio from the 80s.
You know all the songs.
You can maybe not sing every word of every lyrics,
but you can absolutely sing along. It's a happy channel.
It's a happy channel. Uplifting and funny.
For a little while.
Yeah. I do sing along.
Yes, well, would you like to give us some music now? We'll have a listen to it.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's good.
Baby, when I met you, there was peace unknown. I set out to get you with a fine-tooth comb. I was on the inside. There was something going on. You do something to me that I can't explain. Hold me closer and I feel no pain. Every beat of my heart, we got something going on.
Thank you.
this part of the world, radio reception from our own stations is reasonably free from interference from stations in other countries. Reasonably free, that is, compared with the situation in Europe, and especially in Britain.
The estimate is that maybe 1 in 7 of the country's 14 million license holders lives in an area where reception is appalling, either because of interference or for ordinary geographical reasons. So, after dark on Sunday, ordinary radio listening has become almost impossible, and the BBC can only be overheard through a purple of June. They cast in on wavelengths that belong to other countries. Something had to be done about it.
In 1950, conference in Copenhagen, ein Plan zur Kontrolle des Mittelwellenrundfunks in Europa entworfen. Dieser sollte dem gegenseitigen Anschreien und Abpfeifen der Sender ein Ende bereiten und einfache Regeln des guten Benehmens im Radio etablieren. Sie wissen schon, die Regel, die besagt, dass es unhöflich ist, jemand anderen im Gespräch zu...
In the Icelandic radio, always in the morning, is the morning sport that we can do at home with the radio. And my grandmother,
Kristjana,
had this show for 3 or 4 years. She was doing the morning sport in the radio.
I used to do it like all the time. It's kind of, it's like,
I don't know, maybe it's a little bit silly, but it's sincere.
You're just at home and they really tell you to start.
Let's walk on the spot and lift well your knees. And it's very uplifting. And
and it's for all ages. So
it's
nice. It just gets your bloodstream going and your spirit gets a bit...
I don't know. You get a little happy doing it.
For the next few minutes, you are invited to enjoy the comfort that comes from following instructions. Take a momentary rest from the constant calculus required to preserve your personal safety in the modern world. For these next few minutes, you are an island, totally insulated from all else except the physical sensations that your own body conjures for your own enjoyment. Let's start sitting down.
Svo drögum við djúpt inn andan og öndum rólega út.
Your body is an electrical device. The feelings you feel because they run as electrical signals through the circuitry of your body.
Svo lítum við yfir hægri öxlina og...
Identify somewhere in your body that is feeling pleasure right now.
Lítum beint fram.
Your pleasure is electricity.
Við snúum höfðinu og lítum yfir vinstri öxlina og...
Identify somewhere in your body that is feeling pain. Your pain is electricity.
Lítum beint fram.
Your awareness of your own existence is electricity.
Lítum nú upp til himins.
Visualize the sky right now and all the electromagnetic waves buzzing through it.
Lítum niður á nafla.
Visualize the contents of your intestines.
Drögum djúpt inn andan.
Start to walk on the spot. Not too fast. Not so fast that you can't observe the split second in which both your feet are in contact with the earth at the same time.
Vinstri, hægri, vinstri, hægri, vinstri, hægri, vinstri, hægri.
Feel the waves of vibration you send into the earth with each footfall.
Stönsum við báða fætur á gólfinu.
Your feet are conductive plates plugging you into earth ground. Feel the electrical charge passing between your feet and the earth.
Og lyftu vinstri fæti frá jörðinni.
Feel the shift in electrical charge.
Settu fótinn aftur niður og lyftu hægri fæti.
Notice the difference in the electrical current.
Settu fótinn aftur niður og...
Take both feet off the ground. Observe the sublime sensation of being completely enveloped by waves as they crash over you.
Upp, niður, niður.
Come back to the earth. Your arms are antennas.
Varmar niður með síðum. Höldum lófum opnum fram og við.
Reach both your antennas straight up to the sky.
Tegjum hægri handleika aðeins hærra.
The palms of your hands have heightened sensitivity to the electromagnetism in the air around you.
Og tegjum vinstri handleika aðeins hærra.
So do your armpits. Use the supercharged electromagnetic sensitivity of your palms to identify magnetic north in relation to where you are standing. Turn your palms and your armpits to face magnetic north.
Höldum fótunum þétt við jörðina.
Let the electromagnetic waves tickle your armpits.
Við drögum djúpt inn andann.
Feel the fullness of your heart. Or maybe your heart isn't so full today. That's okay. It's still charged.
Og við öndum rólega út.
Your heart runs on electricity. Think of someone you know whose heart has a little bit of your own electromagnetic charge inside of it.
Þegjum arma yfir til vinstri.
Are they north of you?
Tegjum arma yfir til hægri.
Are they south, east or west?
Tegjum beint upp.
Now point your antenna arms in their direction.
Lennum fingurna í sundur eins og hægt er.
Use the supercharged electromagnetic sensitivity of your palms to feel how far away their electromagnetic field is.
Lennum inn.
Feel their waves coursing down the length of your arm. Perhaps you are lucky enough that this person is standing right next to you. Perhaps they are reaching their arms towards you right now. Notice how the electrical charge of their body surges into your own. You are no longer an island.
Látum arma falla niður með síðum.
Perhaps now your arms ache a little.
Thank you.
Welcome now to the Quinnens Tima on Yunge Eylands Varpcast. I'm your host, Gunnhildur Einarsdóttir, and first up in the program today, I'm joined in the studio by a very special guest. Her experiences of marriage and motherhood are, of course, by now legendary. Gunnhildur Kongamóðir joins us from the Icelandic sagas. Welcome on air, Gunnhildur.
Þakka þér fyrir, Gunnhildur.
Vielen Dank, Gunnhildur.
When I read about your time, Gunnhildur, I get the feeling that women controlled everything, not in an obvious way, but rather behind the scenes, plotting and scheming and influencing those people in more visible positions of power. Is that true? And is it hard to have to go about things so indirectly?
Gunnhildur, elskan mín. Þú veist ekkert í þinn haus.
Also Gunnhildur, Schätzchen, du hast ja keine Ahnung. Daran ist rein gar nichts indirekt. Frauen haben schon immer die Kontrolle gehabt. Die Männer denken lediglich, dass sie das Sagen haben. Das Problem ist nur, dass deine Generation von Frauen dies leider vergessen hat. Sie haben vergessen, dass sie die Oberhand haben. Zu meiner Zeit war uns das allen immer völlig klar.
May I ask you, Gunnhildur, why was your punishment of Hrútur so severe? I mean, in a way, he was not cheating on you. He was already engaged before he met you. So he was actually cheating on the other woman with you. Were you hoping that he would come back to you after his marriage in Iceland fell apart?
Say nay.
Also darum ging es nun wirklich nie, überhaupt nicht um eine andere Frau oder diese Frau oder irgendeine Frau. Also wenn du dich erinnerst, betraf mein Fluch nur die Beziehung zu seiner Verlobten, keine anderen Frauen. Mir ist es völlig egal, wen er liebt, inzwischen interessiert er mich überhaupt nicht mehr besonders. Es ging darum, dass er gelogen hat. Ich habe ihn gefragt, ob er eine andere Frau in Island hat und er hat mir direkt ins Gesicht gelogen. Ich wusste es natürlich sowieso schon, aber ich wollte es aus seinem Munde hören. Stattdessen wollte er unsere Affäre verstecken. Dabei hätte er stolz darauf sein sollen, stolz darauf, der Liebhaber der Königsmutter zu sein. Er sollte davon seinen Kindern erzählen und seiner Frau. Es sollte eine Geschichte sein, die seine Familie noch für Generationen weiterträgt. Also ich lasse mich nicht wie eine geheime Liebesaffäre behandeln. Ich gab ihm ein Geschenk. Ich ließ ihn für einen ganzen Winter mein Bett teilen. Er sollte dankbar sein.
I see. But now tell me more about your curse. It was very specific and quite surprising. I mean, one would think that the curse of diminishment would be more devastating to a man than the curse of enlargement.
Fandst du das nicht snjallt hjá mér?
Also fandest du nicht, dass dies ein genialer Zug von mir war? Also ich konnte nicht aufhören zu lachen, als ich hörte, wie seine Frau ihrem Vater von den missglückten Versuchen erzählte. Es geschieht ihm recht. Hrútur dachte, er sei ein großer Mann, aber lass mich ihm zeigen, dass ein großer Mann nichts ist im Vergleich zu einer starken Frau. Und Hut ab an seine Frau, also sie hat wirklich Geschick und Stärke bewiesen, als sie sich von ihm trennte und ihre Ehe sofort annullierte. Genau deshalb hatte ich diesen Fluch ja ausgesucht. Es ist nämlich nicht schwierig zu beweisen, dass der Vollzug der Ehe unmöglich ist, wenn es einen offensichtlichen anatomischen Defekt gibt.
Ja, Melanie Mann.
Übrigens, dieses Wort, wusstest du, dass deine Generation so oft benutzt? Rootsgiering?
Mansplaining.
Mansplaining?
Herr Klären.
Oh.
Ja, emmit. Rootsgiering.
Ja, dieses Wort hat seinen Ursprung also in seinem Namen. Hrútur war völlig selbstverliebt, ein ziemlich nerviger Charakter, also nicht zu mir, aber hinter verschlossenen Türen, also nicht, aber in der Öffentlichkeit. Also so war es jedenfalls. Bis ich ihn ruiniert habe.
Today in New Zealand history. This week, we took recording equipment to the Rimutaka Tunnel, where excitement is mounting
as the boring nears completion. Some of the interviews were recorded above the ground and some below at the face, and so the quality of the recordings were affected by the terrific amount of vibration.
Well, I'm speaking to you now from the face of the river Chagatrimalk on the western portal, which is at Mangaroa. Well, the face itself is before me now, some 22 feet high, a dark volcanic rock, which was entered only a few days ago.
Og háaðinn sem þið heyri hér eru tveir langir borar sem eru með tungsten yfirborði. Og eins og Djón sagði þá verða 60 borholur boraðar áður strengingar hefjast og múli sem myndast þegar þessar strengingu myndar þá göngin. Og þá er þetta allt orðið búið.
Well, we waited patiently for an hour and a half to record the noise of 300 sticks of gelignite to be detonated. We stood about 700 feet away, and the roar was more than our microphone could take. But this is what we recorded. Then, after the dust and smoke had subsided, we made our way back by a battery-driven locomotive to the entrance to the western portal, leaving behind the noise and clatter of men at work.
Iceland, we have like a part of the transport ministry is a ministry for elves.
Yes, there are elves in Iceland.
Like a department for the elves.
Álfur, you know, Álvar, that's the name of a fairy.
Of course, the elves certainly are an important feature. That
there are elves in Iceland, and the funny thing is that when they are putting a road, a new road in the countryside or somewhere, or building some structure or something.
There are basically people who take care of like that when they build a road, that they don't go through the elf houses. So
they have meetings with the people that can see and speak with the elves.
There is like they have to like talk to the people who can see the elves because there are quite a few. I think each part of the country has like at least one who is kind of responsible for that area.
To make peace and make sure that we are not building the roads on the or things have to be done in peace with the elves.
So they just check that out and then they say like we want to build a road there. Is there something? Are there any elf towns in the way or is there any concerns? And then they go and consult with the elves and then they say yeah you can go ahead. And build there, or they advise where to put the road differently. You know, there have been, of course, contractors who have like bypassed this committee because it's you know you have to pay and it costs a bit to get the you know get the proper analysis of the situation. So sometimes you know. Roads have been built just without doing this whole process, and that's of course very bad. You know, then something bad starts to happen. Like
these sort of invisible people are just appearing there, and you.
I mean, it starts kind of simple, you know, the machines break down or something like that, but it can end up quite serious. And a couple of years ago, there was like some deaths connected to.
Important feature that also Icelandic people like to play with.
It's funny, because of course,
you know, there are no elves.
But the thing is, fiction or not, nobody is gonna tell you for sure that it is fiction.
If you ask somebody about that,
we still live.
They will always keep a certain
so that
mystery around that.
Nobody is really going to say there are no elves.
Because it's just so fun, you know, to mess with people, I guess.
But I could totally tell you that there are elves and everything, and it is kind of true.
It's not really true.
It is true. There are elves in Iceland.
Yeah, see?
It's a bit true.
It's true, actually. It is. I mean, there are people who say they see the elves.
My dad has heard when he was getting the horses back in the... it was probably in 55 or 6, he was sent to the countryside. They used to do this back in the days to send children to work in the farms during summer. And my dad was there with relatives during summer, and his job was to go 6 years old in the dark and fetch the horses. And one time he was going to fetch the horses, he hears this incredible choir singing, like complicated, the most beautiful thing he has ever heard.
That was the elves.
Thank you.
And now, an announcement to our listeners. Yunge Eylands Varpcast does its utmost to uphold the highest standards of public broadcasting. Our programming strives to promote the correct history and cultural heritage of island nations in a manner that honors basic democratic rights, human rights, and the freedom of speech and opinion. If you think we've reached the standards of good taste and decency on the air, you can file a formal complaint with the local broadcasting standards authority in your region. Your feedback as a listener and as a citizen is vital in holding us accountable to the interests of the public we serve. Fudgnugget, Cockwomble, Bollocks and Shites. Thank you.
We present a special edition of Radio Digest. Radio Digest number 87, Commonwealth number. We begin with an excerpt from Mr. Holland's statement at his first press conference in London.
Here we are, ladies and gentlemen. It's the Island Steeplechase, the biggest race of the year for island nations with an independent streak as they gallop down the track towards economically prosperous democratic nationhood. The runners are at the 19th century starting line and they're about to go in. It's a deceptive track today, and the off-course bookies are each calling different odds. On the right, gross domestic product, at centre is the OECD sweepstakes, and on the left, the Better Life Index. But the biggest payout of all will be the handsome trophy of total economic and political autonomy that goes to the winning racer. They're lining up, just awaiting the signal. There it is, and they're off. And the first away is Haiti, Pearl of the Antilles, bucking off her squat French jockey at a bloody revolution and going at it alone. But can she keep up a solo sprint around the turn? I don't think so. Haiti losing speed already, buckling under the handicap of astronomical reparation payments and domestic unrest. Tearing clean down the straight now comes Britannia of the Wave. She's going with it early. She's going to test for the lead and gets it. Steamrolling down the track with a bog full of peat to burn, Britannia is dominating the race. I've never seen anything like it. She's hitched the other runners to her own chariot. Ceylon Spice, Jamaican Sugar, Malaysian Rubber, they're all pulling her along with the look of eagles. Trailing is Irish Clover, well off the pace, looking famished. Weaving through a few hoops as they make the turn into the 20th century, Viva La Cuba is following along the outside, but now moving up from out wide, fresh out of the baby races, is God's Own New Zealand. Well conditioned by Britannia's trainers, well fed by her own rapidly growing primary industries, and she's kicking up a lot of turf as she goes, clearing forests, draining wetlands, and knocking down anyone in her path with prior claims to the land. Let's see who'll make an impression on the next stretch. Iceland Viking starting to stride up out front after a shot of American steroids. Made in Japan is building pace, and what beautiful action too. Just look at that highly effective bureaucratic control. So Japan's still on the speed, but has a bit of company here. Taiwan Formosa, late entry to the race, just broken away from mainland China, industrializing fast. She's got a small frame, but she's powering up the field with small yet lucrative consumer electronics. Bouncing fast out of the inside now is the Lion of Singapore. Barely anything to her, but she's following the pace setters. Trainer Lee Kuan Yew keeping the blinkers on and the reins tight. Not an inch of slack given to cultural descent. A swift crack of the whip for even one pop of bubblegum. The field looking well bunched as they approach the 21st century marker. Indonesia making progress now on the run. The Philippines is following them. Malaysia is next. Widest of all is Fiji. Oh, a bad tumble over that fence. No one saw the global financial crisis coming. They've all taken a hit, but Iceland is hurting worse by far. That's what happens when a young filly without good financial regulatory processes gets shook up by foreign money. But, oh no, she's picking herself up. That's the Viking thoroughbred, resilient stock. And once again, she's off and back at the top of the OECD books. Here comes Irish Clover from off the pace as global investors looking for an EU base with low tax rates and English-speaking business partners are putting big bets on her, while Britannia, once the pace setter, has now spit the bit, left the pack, and is lugging in terribly, drifting to the rails. And oh, what's this? They're now calling a penalty on Britannia's lead at the start of the race on account of her gains from the slave trade. Well, with the weight of that, she'll surely be limping to the finish. Into the home turn, Barbados clear out of nowhere has bounded into the race with a kick in the teeth to Prince Charles and her run for the finish. And down the stretch they come. Japan, a narrow leader into the straight, but she's showing a range. The heat of the field is now looking to be New Zealand and Iceland racing in unison. New Zealand rising fast in the global peace index, only an arm's length behind Iceland. New Zealand together with Taiwan and Iceland are handily clearing the COVID fence while others have not.
spot. And New Zealand has been rated the best place on the planet to be if there is a cataclysmic collapse of society. Researchers at the Global Sustainability Institute found this country would be better suited than anywhere else to sustain itself if there was a climate crisis or a global meltdown in supply chains and financial structures. New Zealand headed off Iceland, the United Kingdom, Ireland, and the Australian state of Tasmania. The other countries too, they are islands. You've identified Tasmania being obviously a significant part of Australia. How important is that island aspect to this?
One of the key factors was that isolation, so you weren't having to protect borders or be reliant on neighbours to also not collapse. So that the island nature was quite important in that fight, in coming up with the top five. In the top 10, there are countries that are not islands, but certainly in the top five, being an island was really important.
What do we learn from this type of study other than, I mean, obviously we from time to time hear about billionaires setting up bolt holes in New Zealand, but really, what is the underlying messages that you're trying to get across here? Because this is a scenario, of course, nobody wants.
Denn die offen that time for them Aukwellnatima. But that skündar auf das Ende zu. Und which will come true. It may seem like a thought verzögert. Be patient, thou weint auf sie. These things visuler treffen will not done lieber. Sie, der vermessen Rucker für evil, unaufricht ehe ihm seine Seele in sehr rail. And hin, who do rechte aber wird ever fear in God will win. Und dazu kommt noch, der Wein entücke a person. In the same way, nym, übermütige Mann wird nicht bei der Bürsatte. Der Glennir, schönen Rachen weit a graves, dieser Heldenreich. O er unersättlich in more and more. Wieder Death, subnet alle Völker zu themselves. Und ache them their un people. But all the Adler alle the Babylonian im Han haben, will laugh at them. Und ein Spott will make gauchten auf Babylonians. They will say, wehe terrible, sem reichert mit dem, that steals men fear. Wie long will that nation their ausse Pfandgutbisches to pay them? One day plötzlich darfinen money from, die dich beißen rieße. They will aufwachen, what is happening, ich wegjag müneth with fear. Then, so dass du, wer they will heute wirst, wie ab du viel stolen, ever rein in nations. So sollen people who are left dahin nach dich plündern, wegen des because you have killed many people, or wegen der overigith sem landes and cities and atler ibuar henner. How terrible der ungerechter it comes rich für sein Haus ist. Till through those things, um das agetabicht to live, höher anzuhaucht, rei the safe place. Till that agetabjar be safe zu sein vor dem Ungeivener in dem Harm. Thu to it plans, was deinem Haus ist die Schande tils Maunar. Die avmau many people. Durch deine Schalwim hast du die Seele verwirkt. Wie the Stein wird aus der Mauer Europa out against you wegnimm. Even the wooden Balken bearer or the roof will antworten. How terrible wehe fame for the nation der Städte mit Brandraub the city. Und Grund for that nation that of Unbündigkeit start a town. See, heavens, gamer sleekless will send fire for destroy what else scharen, das Völker fürs Feuer arbeiten, or Fjordflocker, the nicht will be for a knecht. Then the Erden mund will be filled werden von der King of the Lord's greatness. eins og the water ávarins kavrund bitte sie.
Yes, I have.
Yeah, it was really, really incredible.
I think it's fair to say a mind-blowing experience. On so many levels.
It was 1981 or two. 1981. So I was a child, old enough though to remember. And I believe we were driving past us. It started.
I don't know if it's still doing it or was doing it. It was just showing off some smoke. I didn't really see
so
it. And then I saw a little bit of...
What I saw
of
was quite incredibly powerful.
Because
it
you
was
feel
this
the smell and all these...
The temperature.
This incredible heat.
Sulfat sort of smell and it's like...
the relentlessness and the...
I mean, it's totally... Sort of
and the sound.
Toxic environment.
Very special sound.
And just the power of it
as
well.
It's very hard to describe.
It was this cold, gray, thick clouds, like bursting up in the air. It's like this super thick.
Sort of creeps towards you.
Very much on the move. Clouds that are just like constantly growing and growing and growing and growing.
And you really feel sort of drawn to it and you want to go close and you want to almost touch it, but of course you can't.
You felt,
because
felt
it's
a bit,
dangerous.
You know, felt a bit dizzy after all this. Gases that you were confronted with.
it's very magnetic in that
but,
sense.
Yeah, I'm okay. So,
it's very dramatic.
Yeah, that was my active volcano experience.
We've all seen the incredible TV images of lava flowing from an erupting Mount Fagradalsfjall. Is that how you pronounce it or something like it?
Yeah, it's kind of close, yeah. Yep.
It'll do for now. So...
Yeah.
You went there. Now, you and your partner, Guðni, what's the pronunciation of your partner's name? Because it's quite a long Icelandic name.
Yeah, Gunnhildur Helgadóttir.
Fantastic. Right. You and Guðni got close enough to this erupting volcano to feel the heat on your face. You were right beside the lava. What an experience.
Yeah, it was really incredible. But actually, what was even more exciting was the time leading up to the eruption.
Well, scientists in Iceland are warning that a volcano which has been dormant for 800 years could erupt at any time.
It was this, I think, over 1 month where we had like
the
a lot of earthquakes.
The country's been hit by more than 20,000 small earthquakes in
like
the past 10 days.
Getting more and more. It was a bit like a birth, you know, like it's not stoppable. You know that something's going to happen. But it was so fascinating that actually nobody knew what would happen. You know, there were all these scientists and all these research, like they were had all this technology and were really monitoring it super close. But no, they could not say that there would be an eruption.
We can speak now with the senior correspondent at Iceland's public broadcaster, RUV, Ingo Sigfusen. Ingo, thank you for being with us this morning.
Very nice to speak to you guys.
But there were always these scientists on the news. Like.
So why is it that it's thought this volcano could blow?
Yeah, so...
Well, we've absolutely no idea.
Something happens.
You just accept it.
Yeah, that's a bit weird feeling.
I have to say, I find it rather exciting. having the danger at hand at any time.
It's scary to feel them.
I don't feel frightened because I believe that if something happens, people would always know what to do somehow.
But it is also part of life.
People have been living like this, of course, for centuries and centuries.
It's just a part of your existence.
Yeah, but usually you're not so obsessed with it.
This is big, you know, you can talk about the ocean or
it's not only volcanoes, it's also earthquakes or weather.
It's more powerful than anything, so
it has somewhere in the back of the mind, you have this.
So when it goes, you feel how big it is, how
you are actually not so important.
Strength of it is.
You know, I sometimes think about it like a
you're nothing.
Like a wound, and you have a little crust on the wound, and you can just scratch it off. That's a bit how I feel of civilization in Iceland. You know, Iceland is like a body, and all the people are just a little wound, and you could actually very easily just scratch it off, and then
erupt.
You're gone.
It can just explode,
and it would all be, you know, it would all heal really fast again.
The rapid way in which nature can spread her forces and invade new territory was brought home to many people in the recent war. Here in London, it wasn't long before patches of blitz ground were taken over by plants and birds which had never bred in the city before. Most of these are harmless, but in Berlin, one of the new arrivals isn't so by any means. Here's Patrick Smith to report from them.
For a long time now, the open spaces torn by the war have been playgrounds for many forms of wildlife, which one would never expect to find in a great city such as Berlin. I've seen rabbits, for example, scurry past the dilapidated Brandenburg Gate in the heart of Berlin, and a place where east meets west. There is, however, one form of wildlife here which is far less welcome, the increase of which is causing the Berlin authorities in all four sectors of the city a headache. Someone in their statistical department, no doubt, has estimated that there are at the moment well over 3 million rats in the ruins and cellars of this city. Only the other day, I saw two of them basking brazenly in the autumn sunshine on a ruined wall. No doubt, more than one member of the Berlin Sanitary Department would be prepared to pay all a Pied Piper would ask to rid them of this persistent pest. Though today, the piper would have to play his way through the Soviet zone to get here.
And with that report from Patrick Smith in Berlin, we end Radio News Rio, Pacific Edition number 3676. We shall be on the air at the same time tomorrow, 06:30, Village Mean Time.
Now, the Yunge Eylands forecast through to midday tomorrow. Britain, southerly, slight. New Britain, following, at most, Zealand. Later, New Zealand, water or becoming rain. Iceland. Yes. New Iceland. Everywhere. At first. Occasionally. Caledonia. Veering out. Good. New Caledonia. Severe gale to good.
Good.
But.
And after dark, the Kiwis came out. They didn't seem to notice the microphone, but carried on their conversation as though no one was listening, and this is what they said. Here is the voice of the Kiwi. Yes, that's the voice of the kiwi recorded at Green Meadows. Would you like to hear it again?
Mamma geymir gullin þín, gamla leggjó og völu skrín. Við skulum ekki vakum dimmar nætur. Það margt sem myrkrið veit, minn hugur þungur. Oft ég svartan sandin leit, svíða græna lengi reit. Í jökli